In the country of Zuman in Persia, there lived a Greek king. This king had a skin disease and all his doctors were unable to cure him. At that time, a very clever physician came to his court. Sir, I know that no physician has been able to cure your majesty, but if you follow my instructions, I will promise to cure you without any medicines or outward application.
If you could make me all right, I will make your entire generation rich.
The physician went to his house and made a polo club. The handle of which he hollowed out and put it in the drug he wished to use. Then he made a bale, and with these things he went the next day to the king. Sir, I would like to play polo with you. The king gladly agreed and took the physician to the ground. Sir, take this stick and strike the ball. When the handle of the club is warmed by your hand, the medicine will penetrate throughout your body. Then you must return to your palace, bathe, and go to sleep. And when you wake up tomorrow morning, you will be cured. The king played polo with his men. After some time, he felt hot with the medicine. He returned to his palace and woke up the next day morning. Your Highness, your face is glowing.
Your Majesty, you're looking as handsome as before. You are perfectly all right.
The king was overjoyed. The king called the physician and gave him the richest gifts. The king was in all praise for the physician. The minister of the court felt jealous of the physician. The minister was looking for the right opportunity to talk to the king. One day,
Your Majesty, I have something important to tell you.
Yes, tell me.
Please do not get angry. How is that you have believed a new physician? He has been sent by our enemies to kill you.
Minister, will you stop this? If you talk more, you will be hanged.
Your Highness, I knew that you will not believe me. If a person can cure you without giving medicine directly, how long will it take for him to kill you?
Minister, I know that you're speaking out of sheer jealousy. You cannot change me. If I listen to you, I will also repent like the man in Parrot's story.
May I know the story?
Once there was a merchant, and he had a lovely wife. The merchant used to travel a lot. One day in the market, he saw a parrot. "Sir, please come. This parrot will be your great friend." The merchant was anxious to see the parrot. "Sir, please take it. It can talk well and it can tell you whatever happens at your house." "Is it? Can you talk well?"
"Yes, I can guard your house well."
"I like this parrot. I will take it." The merchant bought the parrot from the seller. He took it to his house. From that day, the parrot started telling everything to the master, whatever happened at home. "Shaina, are you taking care of the house or not?"
"Why? What happened?"
"Today, two of our servants have stolen the food and you were dancing in your room at that time." The wife bowed her head, unable to answer. Days went like this. Shaina got yellings from her husband every day. Shaina decided to kill the parrot. One day, she called her servants.
"Do as I say. No questions asked. Keep a handmill under the bird's cage. Throw water down from above the cage. Take a mirror and turn it in front of its eyes from left to right by the light of a candle."
The servants did it during the night. The merchant came home the next morning and spoke with the parrot. "What happened last night?"
"Master, the lightning, thunder and rain disturbed me so much all night long that I cannot tell you what I have suffered."
The merchant became wild. "You fool! You are lying! There is no place for you here." He opened the cage, took the parrot and threw it on the floor. In the process, the parrot lost its life. A few days later, the merchant understood that his wife has cheated the parrot. He repented for it throughout his life. "Minister, I don't want to be like the foolish merchant."
"Your Majesty, I know well that the physician is a spy. If he can cure you without giving you external medicine, how long will it take for him to kill you? Cut off his head and save your life."
Speaking continuously about the physician, the king was confused. Being a weak personality, finally he agreed to what the minister said. "I think that will be the best way." He then ordered one of his ministers to fetch the physician, who came at once. "I have to free myself from you by taking your life." The physician was astonished when he heard that he has to die. His whole body shivered. "What crimes have I committed, Your Majesty?" "I have learned that you are a spy and intend to kill me. But I will be first to kill you." At this cruel order, the physician threw himself on his knees. "Spare my life, my lord." All those present begged for his life, but in vain. "At least let me put my affairs in order and leave my books to people who will make good use of them. There is one which I should like to present to your majesty. It is very precious and ought to be kept carefully in your treasury. When you cut off my head, and if your majesty will turn to the sixth leaf and read the third line of the left-hand page, my head will answer all the questions you like to ask." The king, eager to see such a wonderful thing, put off his execution to the next day and sent him with a strong guard to his house. The next day, there was a great crowd assembled in the hall to see his death. The physician went up to the foot of the throne with a large book in his hand. He carried a basin on which he spread the covering of the book and presented it to the king.
Sir, take this book, and when my head is cut off, let it be placed in the basin. Then open the book and my head will answer your questions. But I implore your mercy that I am innocent.
Your prayers are useless and you shall die.
He took the book from the physician's hands and ordered the executioner to do his duty. The head was so cleverly cut off that it fell into the basin. The head started speaking.
Your Majesty, open the book.
The king did so, and finding that the first leaf stuck against the second, he put his finger in his mouth to turn it more easily. He did the same thing till he reached the sixth page and did not see any writing on it.
Physician, there is no writing. Turn over a few more pages.
The king went on turning, still putting his finger in his mouth, till the poison in which each page was dipped took effect. His sight failed him, and he fell at the foot of his throne. When the physician's head saw that the poison had taken effect and that the king had only a few minutes to live, it screamed,
"Tyrant, see how cruelty and injustice are punished!"
Scarcely had it uttered these words than the king died, and the head also lost the little life that had remained in it. That is the end of the story of the Greek king. If the Greek king had spared the physician, he would not have died. The same thing applies to you. Now, I am going to throw you into the sea.
My friend, do not do such a cruel thing.
Let me be out and I will make you rich.
If you give me your promise to do this, I will open the lid. I do not think you will dare to break your word.
The genie promised, and the fisherman lifted the lid.
He came out at once in smoke, and then, having resumed his proper form, the first thing he did was to kick the waves into the sea.
Frightened fisherman, but the monster laughed.
Do not be afraid. I only did it to frighten you and to show you that I intend to keep my word. Take your nets and follow me.
He began to walk in front of the fishermen, who followed him. They passed in front of the town and went up a mountain and then down into a great plain where there was a large lake lying between four hills.
Throw your nets and catch the fish.
The fisherman did as he was told, hoping for a good catch as he saw plenty of fish. There were four quite different kinds, some white, some red, some blue, some yellow. He caught four, one of each color. As he had never seen any like them, he admired them very much, and he was very pleased to think how much money he would get for them.
Take these fish and carry them to the Sultan, who will give you more money for them than you have ever had in your life. You can come every day to catch fish in this lake, but be careful not to throw your nets more than once every day. Otherwise, some harm will happen to you. If you follow my advice carefully, you will find it good.
The monster struck his foot against the ground, which opened, and when he had disappeared, it closed immediately. The fisherman resolved to obey the monster exactly, so he did not cast his nets a second time, but walked into the town to sell his fish at the palace. The Sultan saw the fish and was astonished.
Take these fish and give 400 gold pieces.
The fisherman was very happy He met the needs of his family and made good use of it. The cook had cleaned the fish, put them in a pan with some oil to fry them. When she thought they were cooked enough on one side, she turned them on the other. But as soon as she had done so, the walls of the kitchen opened and there came out a young and beautiful damsel. She was dressed in an Egyptian dress of flowered satin, and she wore earrings, a necklace of white pearls, bracelets of gold set with rubies, and she held a wand in her hand. She went up to the pan. She struck one of the fish with her rod.
"Hey fish, are you doing your duty?"
The fish raised their heads together and answered,
"Yes, yes. If you reckon, we reckon. If you pay your debts, we pay ours. If you fly, we conquer, and we are content."
When they had spoken, the maiden upset the pan and entered the opening in the wall, which at once closed and appeared the same as before. When the cook had recovered from her fright, she lifted up the fish which had fallen into the ashes and not fit to serve up to the Sultan. She began to cry. The Sultan was informed. The fisherman was being to bring the fish again, and the Sultan was surprised to see all the incidents.
"I cannot rest. These fish signify some mystery I must clear up. Fisherman, take me to the lake where you have taken the fish."
The fisherman took the king. They climbed the mountain and then on the other side saw the lake as the fisherman had described. The water was so clear that they could see the four kinds of fish swimming about in it. They looked at them for some time, and then the Sultan ordered them to make a camp by the edge of the water.
"I have resolved to clear up this mystery. I will stay here, find out the truth, and come back."
"Your Majesty, I am scared. Please do not stay here."
"I want to solve the mystery. You go to the palace."
That night, the Sultan went around the mountains. He saw a beautiful palace decorated with gold and diamonds on one of the mountains. The palace was surrounded by colorful birds and sparkling fountains. When he was admiring the palace, he saw a young man with rich clothes in the palace who was looking very sad.
"Dear young man, who are you? You look handsome, but why are you sad? Look at me."
He opened his body. His body was made of black marble. The king was shocked.
"My God! What is this?"
"Sir, I am the prince of this palace and my father is the king. I married my cousin, but she liked one of my servants, deceived me and made me a rock."
"Do not worry, I'll help you. When will your princess come?"
"She comes in the evenings and beats me every day. Her favorite servant stays in the next room of the palace."
Sultan made a plan. He tied the servant and locked him in a room. He acted like the servant and slept in the cot, covering his face. The princess entered the room. The Sultan was sleeping with his face covered.
"Dear, are you all right? Why are you dull?"
"How can I sleep when your husband cries all night? The people of this town come out of water and curses. Change them to their original form."
"All right, I'll change them as per your wish."
The princess uttered some magic words. the prince and the people of the town to their usual form.
Are you happy now?
What happened?
Why don't you remove the blanket from your face?
Without answering, the Sultan removed his blanket, took a sword and killed her. The princess died on the spot.
The Sultan went to meet the prince.
Rejoice! Your enemy is no more.
What happened?
I have killed the princess.
Thank you, sir. You have given life to our kingdom. The kingdom of black ISILs. We will never forget the help rendered by you.
No problem. I have to go back to my kingdom. Take care and have a happy life.
They called the fisherman and gave him lots of presents and money.
These stories were told every night to Sharia by his wife Shahrazade for 1001 nights. Finally, after telling all the stories, she pleaded the king not to kill her. The king Sharia appreciated her intelligence, spared her life and made her his queen. The practice of killing young women was stopped and the whole country appreciated Queen Shahrazade.